I'm going to break down the animation techniques and copious amount of effects I used to create this animation and how to embrace limitations in order to create that warm vintage feel. I found this tattoo design amongst some of my sketches from over a year ago and thought, well, this is a bit dumb. Let's take this idea and give it a much grander animation than it deserves. I created the main artwork in Procreate. To keep with the retro aesthetic, I knew animating the door opening frame by frame would be my best option to make it look convincing. And because frame by frame animation is more time consuming, I was conscious to keep the palette really restricted on the fridge to just 3 colors and let a bit of brush texture do the talking for the detail. I animated the door opening in Callipeg, my favorite animation app on the iPad. I first set up some guides for the arc of the door and then roughly sketched in how the door would open. There's 2 frames of anticipation of the door being pressed in, then 6 frames of it opening and easing into the final position where the drawings get closer together as it slows down to the final pose. And this is all at 12 frames per second, or animating on 2s in the old tongue. And then it was just a process of coloring the sides for the cleanup. I did them on separate layers, and that probably wasn't necessary, but as they say, better to have layered and lost than never to have layered at all. I also did a shadow of the door on the inside of the fridge to add to the illusion, and the door handle, which was only 3 drawings. But for 1 frame, I did adjust the shadow so it would be more accurate, which can make or break a freezer door animation, so do be careful. Last of all, I animated the star sparkling, just getting bigger and smaller. Then I imported all of the animation and Procreate layers into After Effects. First, I animated the skull coming out of the freezer, just with position. And I obscured the bottom half just using an alpha matte drawn out of a shape layer. Then I animated the skull to have a bit more of a fluid, bouncy motion where it moves up a little further than it needs to and settles after a few subtle bounces. This was all done with a lot of tweaking inside the graph editor. And I added some offset rotation to the jaw as well. Then, sometime a little bit later, I abandoned this animation because it just looked too fluid and, well, too After Effects-y. So I went for a much simpler, more ominous raising of the skull straight out of the freezer. It's much less flashy, but I think it's got a bit more charm to it that's reminiscent of some of the limited animation techniques that compositing tools used in the first motion graphic elements back in the 70s and 80s. Now for the background. I tried some fancy 3D rendered space stock footage, but that didn't work. This needed to look authentically vintage without actually being that. So I raided NASA's website for some real space pics. The real candid shots of stars in their natural environment, not these obvious fake ones. I settled on this one and then gave that background image a subtle scaled down animation. Now to the effects, and I am going to add all of the final effects in this comp to take this to this. Now the first effect we're gonna add is a bit of drop shadow to all of the separate animated elements here, to the skull, to the fridge, and the stars. Now, this might seem a bit out there, but I do have a sound, logical explanation for it. Before digital animation, most animation was done on transparent celluloid sheets, or cells, and each frame was layered over a background. And those celluloid sheets were thick enough that the paint and ink on them left a shadow. And you can see that clearly in older cartoons if you look closely. So I'm gonna make these ones a little bit subtler, 25%. Copy and paste that onto the jaw and the stars and fridge as well. Now on its own, this may not do much, but it's this and many other subtler touches that altogether will really help to sell this animation that it wasn't done digitally, when in fact, every step of the way, it is. Next, I am going to drop a looping texture over everything. This is one that I use all the time and I have a separate tutorial for how to create your own ones. Here we're gonna add a curves effect to just darken it a touch. We're going to set its blending mode to screen, so only the white show, and drop its transparency to 50%. So now there's just these tiny subtle specks that mimic some damage to the film or magnetic tape or whatever we're pretending this animation was printed on. Now, I love these traditional animation techniques and looks, but certainly not exclusively. Modern digital looking animation is equally as incredible. And if you want to see just what's possible at the cutting edge of animation just in your browser, you want to check out this video's sponsor, Rive. Rive is an amazing browser-based design and animation tool, but what really separates it is that you can use it to build interactive motion graphics that transition and mix animations based on events and user interactions. Those interactive graphics can run on just about any platform you'd need them to. One of the biggest draws to Rive is its state machine, which is a really intuitive way to create those interactions. You can create different states of the animation and link up what interactions will trigger those to change in this really intuitive flowchart. Here's an example by JC Toon. We've got a couple of states of animation where it's off and idle, and then also blinking. And here it is in the state machine. We can see to transition between them, the condition is set to whether the mouse is pressed or not, and we can click to see it progress through each of those animations in real time. And in this one, we have three walk cycles, beginner, intermediate, and expert, and each one is just one button press that morphs between them all, which is really satisfying and surprisingly clear from the state machine flowchart. You can find a lot of animations like this in the Rive community, where you can also publish your own. And if you like what you see, you can click open in Rive and see exactly how it was put together. Try it out for free at rive.app. There's a link in the description. And from here, we have very good news. All the remaining effects are on a single adjustment layer. We'll pop that on top of everything, and we're going to rename that to effects because we always label our layers. And you should be warned, this is a 4K comp, so you might need to tone down some of these effects if you're doing it in a 1080p comp. Now, the first set of effects we're going to add, I showed can be used together in my last video on blurs, which is a blur and sharpen combo. So we're going to add a Gaussian blur and give it about an 8 pixel blur, pretty subtle. And then we're going to add sharpen and sharpen it up to around 300 until it's essentially undoing that blur. And as the sharpen is undoing that blur, we get some really interesting artifacts left on the image. There are some changes to the color and brightness around the edges of objects, which is reminiscent of some old screens. And we're still keeping this pretty subtle because we've got a few effects to go. And the next effect we are going to add is Deep Glow. And yes, this is a paid plugin, but you can replicate this with just After Effects regular glow stacked on top of one another, increasing the radius as you go. But Deep Glow is a reasonably priced plugin that I find a lot of use for, and it just saves me a lot of time. Again, there'll be a link in the description. Now, we need this subtle, because right now, it is anything but. So let's reduce the radius from 500 down to 250, and let's decrease the exposure from 1 to around 0.4. There, now we can at least make out what's going on. And this is still lightening up our image a lot. So what I like to do is to add a curves effect and place that above our deep glow in the effect stack, and then just drag down the white values to essentially counteract the brightness that our glow is giving, somewhere around here. Now you will need to continually adjust your curves and maybe your exposure to find a balance that works, but I was really pleased with how well this worked. I love a soft, diffused, blooming look, and this is great for that without just blowing out all your highlights. Now you can try moving the curves below the deep glow effect, so it will darken it after the glow is applied. That kind of really mutes the image, which actually doesn't look too bad, but maybe it's a bit too much for what we want. So let's put the curves back above the deep glow, and you know what, let's not be afraid, let's add another curves again after the deep glow and just drag the highlights down a touch. And of course you can tweak these and adjust these to find a look that suits what you want. And we're also going to enable the chromatic aberration on deep glow by checking it here. Chromatic aberration is where the color channels split slightly and we get some colorful fringes on the edges of shapes. Now, if you're not using deep glow, I've got a tutorial on how to create chromatic aberration just using stock AEFX2. And my number one tip for chromatic aberration is that a subtle touch is essential. Too often I see it being used and feel like I need those blue and red 3D glasses to actually see what's going on. So I'm going to take the amount down to 0.15, and that is much, much subtler. Here's it off and here's it on. We just want to see a slight bit of color in these edges. With a lot of these effects, we really just want to feel what they're giving to the image rather than seeing it and registering consciously that, oh, this image is having its color channels split or this is being blurred and sharpened. We want them to be subtle enough that whoever's watching this isn't going to be able to sort of break them down instantly as they're watching it. They're just going to feel, oh, this looks warm and vintage. This effect is all about those small touches, those design and animation decisions that collectively build up to a believable result, not just one effect that you can lather on thickly and call it done. Now, I've got a lot of effects here, so I'm going to close them all down so we can have some more space here. Now we're going to add one of my favorite techniques, which you may well have seen me use before, which is to add a tiny, subtle shake to the whole composition. And we're going to do that by adding the transform effect. and that gives us, in our effects panel, all of our favorite transform properties, anchor point, position, scale, rotation, all the hits. And we essentially just want to shake its position property a little bit. So we are going to add a wiggle expression. So let's Alt or Option click the stopwatch next to position, which will bring up our expression window here. And we're just going to type in wiggle and then in parentheses 6, 2. And those numbers are the frequency and the amplitude. So 6 times a second, it is going to move up to 2 pixels. And now there's just the tiniest, subtlest shake that kind of mimics a slightly loose film reel or a playhead in a VCR. Again, this is a 4K comp. You might want to take the wiggle position down to a 1 if you're doing it in a 1080p comp. And this is just one more thing to remove that digital sheen from the overall image. And because this is moving around the whole composition, you might get a 1 pixel thick black edge at the top or bottom of your comp. So we can just increase the scale to 101% and that should be fine. And then we are going to add some film grain, which we're going to do with noise HLS auto. We're going to set the noise type to grain. Let's actually zoom in quite a bit here so we can really see it happening. Let's put the lightness to 5, which is pretty subtle considering. Let's move the grain size up to 2 and the animation speed down to 12. So here it is on, here it is off, and now let's see it in action. And with all these effects, it will take a while to ramp preview. So you might need to pop out and grab a cup of Earl Grey. Here it is close up and zoomed out to 100% as well. Grain is so nice. It's just that icing on the cake. And the very last thing, which might be the most important, is to add some suitably icy synth jams to really set the mood. And if we toggle this effects adjustment layer on and off, we can really see what a big difference those make. Honestly, I don't mind how it looks before, but all of these effects together really work to bring that vintage retro animation feel. And I can't emphasize this enough, these effects work best if you are subtle with them and adjust them to suit your subject matter. But if you want to start by just grabbing these effects straight out of my project, you can. You can download this project file for free using a link in the description. And if you find yourself with an unquenchable thirst for more motion techniques, I've got an advanced motion design course with a whole lesson dedicated to just using effects, breaking down effects you see to build your own recipes and effect stacks to create your own unique results. A link to all of that is in the description. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next one.